Good evening. This is What's Going On. I'm Zoë Vikstrom, and our guest this evening is Dr. Ralph Hexter, who is Interim Chancellor at UC Davis. Good evening, Mr. Hexter.
Hi, Zoë. Good to be here.
I wanted to thank you for being on our show and for taking your time to be here tonight. So let's start with your experience as a student. When you went to Harvard, you brought a love of French and the opera. Can you talk about your life as an undergraduate?
I actually loved being an undergraduate. I had a wonderful time. It's true, I was completely devoted to literature, particularly medieval literature. I think I was one of those high school, probably even junior high school readers of Tolkien's Ooh. Rings. you know, the Ring trilogy, and of course, The Hobbit. And also, I was into opera, as you said, and I sometimes think my preparation for being a medievalist or getting into comparative literature was, as I put it, from the two rings, Tolkien's Ring and Wagner's Ring, both of which I was a fanatic devotee of in high school. So I took a lot of languages, a lot of literature courses, and I generally had a great time.
I was a big fan of The Hobbit and Tolkien's books as a kid as well. So your work in graduate school was at Oxford in England, and then a PhD at Yale, and research in Munich, Germany. So what challenges did you face as a graduate student?
Gosh, as a graduate student? Well, I was very fortunate to be able to go study in Oxford, and you know, I had a really good time. It was an opportunity to really deepen my knowledge of Latin and ancient Greek literature, which I actually had started while I was an undergraduate. So, but you know, Oxford has wonderful long vacations, and I tended to like to visit the continent then, and so I really had a wonderful opportunity to get to know a couple of countries fairly well, Germany most of all, Italy a little bit, and challenges graduate student. You know, again, my graduate career was a little bit odd, I suppose, because I only spent 2 years really in residence at Yale as a graduate student, and you know, it's interesting when I think about the funding for graduate students, I didn't actually have a scholarship, and so I went back to Europe on a fellowship supported by the German government to do research, and that's what took me to Munich, a city I'd visited once before and said, gosh, if I ever had the chance, I'd love to live here. And I got to indulge a lot of my passions there, opera and theater and art above all.
Okay, so what? Tell me about Germany. What do you like about it?
Well, there's so many different parts. I'll share a few different things. First of all, I love speaking German. I know that German has a reputation of mm-hmm. being difficult, and I'm not sure I speak it perfectly, but you know, you can build very complicated grammatical structures in German, and that's something I enjoy. Also, reading the literature. But one of the more interesting opportunities I had, and you have to understand this is, gosh, the mid-70s, I had the opportunity to go and stay with a family in East Berlin, got a visa okay. and go behind the wall and live for first 2 weeks and then for 3 weeks a little bit later in East Berlin, long before the wall came down. So that was quite a fascinating wow. experience. Very, very interesting. But I actually then, when I did my research, spent more time in Munich, which is very much not in East Germany. It's in Bavaria, and good food, good art, and a beautiful situation. But probably the most important thing is that I ended up meeting my partner, now husband, there. And we've been together, well, it'll be 37 years quite soon.
Wow, congratulations. Yeah, yeah. Is he German?
He is German, or was. Now he's an American. But he emigrated from Germany to the United States a few years after we met and went through that whole process. Now he's totally American.
That's awesome. You're recognized as a scholar in comparative literature. What are your areas of interest?
So the university, I have an appointment both as a professor of classics mm-hmm. and comparative literature. And sort of as traditional by classics, we mean the Greco-Roman world, the ancient world of around the Mediterranean. So what I work on primarily is the tradition and reception of ancient literature, perhaps more Latin than Greek, but I've done Greek as well, in the Middle Ages, how it was interpreted, how, for example, a society very, very different from the society for which the Roman poets wrote, read those texts, which referred to things that they didn't really approve of in a number of different ways. So how did they learn to reinterpret them? How did they readapt them? And then that just continues actually on up to our own age, the translations and adaptations of ancient material. I'm quite fascinated by that.
Okay. Do you have a favorite classic?
You know, I actually think it would be Virgil's epic poem, The Aeneid, which I've taught a few times. Okay. It's, I find, not only monumental and moving, but also I find so many interpretive challenges there. And I suppose also my interest in the immense impact it's had over centuries. Quite honestly, probably with the exception of the Bible, it was the most influential work, at least into the 19th century. Since then, the number of people studying the classics has dropped precipitously.
You have taught at Yale and been a teacher and administrator at Colorado, Cal Berkeley, and Hampshire College, which is the most concentrated college town in America. What has your experience taught you about the responsibilities of leadership?
Well, I would say that you have to take your time. You have to learn the context of the college or university you're involved with. You have to learn what the values are. I even put it in terms of learning a language. Because when you start dialoguing with the faculty and the students, and you might have some ideas or suggestions, you need to know how to translate that into precisely what moves that culture.
Okay. What efforts do you make to get student input? I know you had breakfast, you said, with Alex.
Well, so, it's interesting. I remember at Hampshire when I was the college president, mm-hmm. following a tradition that the previous president had established, I went to the dining hall every Monday morning for breakfast and just had an open table. Whoever wanted to come and sit down and talk with me, we had breakfast together for about an hour and a half. And it's interesting, there were some people who came pretty regularly, mm-hmm. and then there were others who only came when there was a burning issue that they had. But that's so important. What I'm doing right now, I think in some ways, the transition between Hampshire College, which is 1,400 students, mm-hmm. and UC Davis, which is, well, if you count the graduate and professional students, 35,000 students, 28,000 undergraduates. One of the things that actually astonishes me is how, despite its size, I think a lot of our students, of course, they have some large classes, no doubt mm-hmm. about that, but through their activities, they find places to make it an intimate experience. Whether they're involved like Alex is in mm-hmm. ASUCD or the sports teams. It really is somehow a small town, many small towns. But to your question, when I took on the acting chancellor role, now I'm interim chancellor, but that's just as a mm-hmm. title change, I proposed to students that if anyone was interested, they should shadow me for part of my day. And I was delighted that immediately we had over 20 volunteers, and since then other people have added their names to the list. I think we've probably have 40 now. And so since May, I've been having usually a pair of students at a time join me for a portion of my day, because I think it's a great opportunity for them to see or just get a taste of the many different things that the university involves. For example, one of the students who shadowed me early on had to suffer through an hour-long meeting on compliance. But it's interesting to realize that part of our university, and you know UC Davis also has a medical center, a school of medicine, a school of nursing in Sacramento, is there so many issues of compliance and, you know, following this rule and that, and we take it very seriously, obviously. It's, I think, an interesting perspective for students to realize that while they, day in, day out, see a certain part of the university, we have an administration and lots of staff who are focused on a tremendous range of things you wouldn't even know. Like yesterday, just as an example, I was out at Bodega Marine Lab, at Bodega Bay, which UC Davis runs. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, again, we had students along on that trip to see the work that's being done there.
Wow. So there's a lot of opportunities that make students feel like the college is more intimate when it's really big.
It is. And, and I have to say, I hope it's not too much of a stress on my staff, but I really love this program of students shadowing me, so I know we'll continue it.
Okay. Sounds like you have a lot of people who want want to do that.
Since I work every day, there's no lack of meetings for people to join me at.
So what is your evaluation of Linda Katehi?
Oh, gosh. Linda Katehi, of course, was chancellor when I came. She hired me. I think she's actually one of the people who saw very clearly the greatness of UC Davis. And I think everyone at the university knows how great we are, but we have a tradition of being perhaps overly modest, sometimes hiding our light beneath a bushel, being the best kept secret. And Chancellor Katehi, you know, took the measure of all that we were and helped make sure that we were confident in getting that message out. And I think that that is, it's not bragging, it's not arrogance, but I think we are now projecting and communicating much more of what it is that we do, whether it's our focus on teaching, whether it's the immense amount of research we do. You know, leaders like that, most leaders are called on to be change agents of one sort or another. And it's a very challenging thing to do. I was talking about that in my own sense of leadership.
Yeah.
And I think that we're now in a very, very better place thanks to her period as chancellor.
Okay. Just because you guys now have a reputation, or you had the same reputation before, but now it's more known because of Chancellor Katehi?
Well, I think that she helped us feel confident about communicating that. And it is, you know, it's something you have to work at because everyone is familiar with some of the older established universities. And also part of the challenge of communicating what UC Davis is both to honor our heritage as, you know, the original ag school of the University of California, the Aggies.
Yeah.
And of course our tremendous expertise in veterinary medicine, but also let people know that we've got lots of other parts. We are an enormous and comprehensive university. Perhaps pointing out that in areas that really are key to meeting the challenges of the 21st century, feeding what will become 9 or 10 billion people, doing it in a way that respects the environment, attending to a sort of complex interaction that we call one health between, for example, diseases. I mean, Zika is a very good example. Diseases that move from animals, whether they're wild animals or insects or farmyard livestock, to humans, given what we have at UC Davis, a School of Medicine, a College of Agricultural and Environmental Sciences, and a veterinary school, there's no university better positioned to work collaboratively on those kinds of challenges. And so I think it's also adding some richness to the messaging that helps people see what is relevant about all the work we do now.
All right, so moving into the future, you had a distinguished career at UC Berkeley as chair of the Comparative Literature Department and Dean of Languages, and then you were Dean of the Deans of Letters and Sciences. You have proposed the creation of a Dean of Letters and Sciences position, and the Chemistry Department is trying to block your final decision. Use this problem to describe your administrative philosophy and how you viewed shared governance with the faculty and with the graduate and undergraduate student body.
Sure. Shared governance is one of the bedrock values of really any great research university, certainly of the University of California. Mm-hmm. And the regents of the University of California long ago established the Academic Senate as having authority over such things as curriculum, admission standards, very, very important content issues. In addition, we have a wonderful tradition, and this is encouraged, of consulting with the Academic Senate. So to take the example that you use, this idea of maintaining the College of Letters and Science mm-hmm. as one college, and even having one dean for the college instead of three divisional deans. It's an idea that we discussed over 3 years of committees and consultations. The first year, because in fact, not just chemistry, but the whole area of math and physical sciences proposed, let's call it a hypothesis, that they should go and form a separate college. So we had a group look at the arguments that they proposed, and this was a group that, in the spirit of shared governance, was co-chaired by one of my administrators, the vice provost for undergraduate education, and the vice chair of the Academic Senate. So this involved that kind of joint, that shared viewpoint. It's an administrative matter in the end, but it's very important to get the input from faculty. And of course, Letters and Science is a college of over 600 Senate faculty and some 30 departments. So there's a lot going on there. In any event, they did their report, and their conclusion was it didn't make sense from their point of view to have math and physical sciences go off and become a separate college, but rather there were lots of ways we could address the challenges that all of the different parts faced. So then we, the chancellor and I, proposed this idea of having one dean. And we had yet another committee filled with faculty from all the different parts, including a member of the chemistry department, look at this at great length. And in the end, they made a recommendation that we should go forward with this. And then we had yet another committee, and I may be wrong, maybe on this committee that we had a member of chemistry, to define the job description and search for the individuals. So I understand that there are some individuals, any number of them, who really still hold in their heart the desire to go in a different direction. But after an extremely long and consultative process, which is, after all, advisory on administrative matters, I feel that we've had a chance for lots of people to share their views. And so I think that's that is the essence of consultation.
And of shared governance. Having all of those opinions together in one room is important.
It is. Shared governance in its strict form is not the same thing as shared government. The administration is still responsible and accountable mm-hmm. for the functioning of the administration. And so it's very, very important to understand that in shared governance, we defer to the Academic Senate on those questions that they have specific authority for, and we listen to advice, but it's not, in the end, a joint decision. Consensus and certainly unanimity is not always required. You have to spend a lot of time listening to questions, responding, mm-hmm. and getting a lot of opinions.
Okay, so the latest campus long-range development plan will cover at least the next 20 years. And this is a two-part question. So first, UCD has the most land of any UC campuses, and yet UCD has the worst record for providing campus student housing at outrageous prices. UCD made a commitment to the city to meet one-third of its student housing needs, and UCD needs to be doing more. How do you think this will all work out?
Well, just as a point of fact, and it's very funny because I was having this discussion with folks today. Mm-hmm. Currently, we house 36% of our students.
Okay.
So
more than the third
more than the
that
third.
You
but,
signed up
but,
for.
Land is one thing. Money is another. And mm-hmm. the cost of developing the infrastructure and, above all, building the buildings, we have that opportunity by using the revenue we get from the housing we rent. But there are a lot of stages in this. And so you should know that the whole system, the UC system, is encouraging and helping the campuses reach the goal of housing 40% of our
okay.
students on campus.
So 4% more than what's currently
yeah,
happening?
But I want to say, I mean, we know that, as you pointed out, we have a lot of land. And Davis, as a town, is, for the students, the vacancy rate is extremely low. Someone has recently cited it to me as less than 1%, 0.2% vacancy rate. This is tremendous stress on our students.
Mm-hmm.
It means that, of course, anything that's available is very expensive, and students have to share it. Or if they can't find anything, they go further afield, which both reduces the opportunity to have that residential experience in a
right.
college town or on campus, and it takes time, and it adds to the energy costs by having commutation.
Mm-hmm.
Particularly if it's further than a bicycle will reach. So, again, not that we have specific plans, but I think that it might be better over some period of time to try to provide housing for 50% of our students to relieve the pressure that they feel and, of course, on the community, because the college town nature of Davis is so important for all of us.
Yeah, it's living here is a chance to be part of the community and to be in the middle of all of the action. Would you guys build houses on what's currently UC Davis land? Is that how would that work?
Yeah, that would be the idea. Is
okay.
And as you point out, we have a good bit of land, and so we've begun to develop west of 113 West
right.
Village. We're certainly going to expand there,
okay.
Both. Primarily single-family homes for faculty and staff, because it's very hard for them to find property to buy in Davis, and we want to keep the commute
mm-hmm.
very, very short, if possible, but also more student housing. But we're also looking, during the time of the long-range development plan, to develop other sites on our campus where more dense housing could be placed for students so that we can
okay.
get to the 40% and, if possible, go even beyond that.
Get to 50. Got
that
it.
That would be great.
So what is your commitment to take the pressure off of the community housing market by providing affordable student housing on campus while protecting Russell Fields?
Well, so I started to talk about that.
You explained a little bit of that.
But the specific issue of Russell Field, I've gotten to know a bit of that dialogue. Mm-hmm. In response to community concern about the amount of Russell Field that we were thinking could be zoned for residents. And mind you, the long-range development plan, these are not specific projects that are planned. It's just a planning document that sort of does zoning and saying this is potential area for development.
Okay.
We went back to the drawing boards. We withdrew that. And though we have planning for the potential of some housing there, we've moved it much further back so there's much more setback from Russell Road, as well as an opportunity for passersby and nearby residents to enjoy the expansive space that they have been used to.
Okay. So on a different note, what are your thoughts about the potential for UC Davis?
My goodness, UC Davis, this is a big question.
It is. Feel free to talk as much as you'd like about this.
So I think UC Davis will continue on its trajectory of recognizing, building on the greatness that we've already established, but finding new areas. For example, I did say that we feel that some of the great, great issues of our century, we, as a society, we have to step up to them. You know, whether it's climate change, and on the one hand, doing what we can to mitigate the increases in climate that are seem to be caused by human activity. I have no doubt of that. But I know that there are a few people who still question that. But nonetheless, we're into climate change, so we would like to slow that down as much as possible. But there's also going to be an enormous amount of work in the areas of adaptation that's required. And so in the area of water resourcing, for example, helping farmers and other processes do what needs to be done with ever less water, or finding ways to recycle it, any number of things, is we really have to attend to that. I think UC Davis also has, because of its interdisciplinary structure and just the range of fields, an opportunity to dig into these questions, whether it's in the food chain or ecology or One Health. Everything is connected to everything else. I mentioned that yesterday we were at Bodega Marine Lab.
Right.
And to hear how it is that the oceans are acidifying because of the runoff from land and human activity on land, and what that's doing to the wildlife. You know, it's also a case that the rising temperatures affect the pH level of the waters, and that definitely impacts the ability of shellfish to form their shells. Or actually, we were there with President Napolitano, and she asked a question of why did a certain kind of salmon suddenly disappear? And basically, one of the major causes of that were logging practices.
Really?
Yes, and dams and logging practices. So my point is just that everything is connected to everything else. And it often takes that kind of concerted, collaborative university research to sort that out. So back to your major question, what about UC Davis? Is we have the research, we also have, we're perfectly positioned very, very close to our state capital. We have lots of connections with policymakers, lawmakers. We'd like to use students who are very, very interested in working in that area, making a difference, help take the scientific research that we have developed and uncovered and see if we could turn that into policy. There's so many examples of that. So that's one of the things that I would like to see UC Davis do even more of. And we're doing so much already. I think another thing that I think about is UC Davis is Davis.
Right.
But we also are so important for our larger region, for Sacramento. And mm-hmm. I mean, in some areas, for example, in healthcare, to provide some of the top level care or trauma care, we really are the only thing going for 33 counties in Northern California. So region is large in that sense, but particularly Sacramento, our capital city, where we already have our health center, our health sciences campus with a medical center. I definitely have a vision that we find more ways to work with our regional partners so that Sacramento also looks at UC Davis and every little town in the area look at UC Davis and say, that's our UC. We have a very, very special relationship with Davis itself. We are in Davis. We bear its name very proudly. But I think that there are lots of people in the area whom we want to inspire to help them feel that UC Davis is their UC.
Okay, so how can Davis community members or Sacramento community members get involved with UCD if they don't actually attend the college?
Well, you know, it ranges from taking advantage of the offerings that we have at the Mondavi Center. Our new Menendez Schrem Museum of Art is opening in a few days, and there will be opportunities like that. But I think that there are other opportunities of accessing what we have, whether it's online, just our websites and our information, for example, or taking a course at like beer brewing or something like that at our university extension. I think we can discover other things. For example, all of UC has the UC Center in Sacramento, which we happen to run for the UC. And there are lectures there on policy. So I think that, and there are dozens of, probably many dozens of public lectures, both on our Davis campus and in the health systems campus in Sacramento. I would like to find opportunities for people in the area who are just interested to tap into those resources.
Okay, and can you tell me a little bit more about the UC Davis Extension program that you just mentioned?
Right, and I want to differentiate. It's funny, at UC Davis, we use the word extension to describe two very different things.
Okay.
So, first of all, there's the Cooperative Extension Program, which is part of our land-grant heritage. These are specialists, most of them are in the College of Agricultural and Environmental Sciences, who build on the work of our faculty to take the research to practical purposes, to actually work with groups of farmers or, you know, gardeners, just home gardeners, to take this knowledge and get it out. So that's one sense of the word extension.
Okay.
What I refer to, university extension, is a continuing education college. It's very common in many universities, and we have a university extension unit that actually has centers in Sacramento and offers courses there. It does a lot of training programs for state governmental agencies as well. So it is non-degree educational programs.
All right. So, and any community member can take that, take those courses?
Well, it depends. You have to sign up for them.
But,
And those are fee-based courses. Mm-hmm. The cooperative extension is actually a part of the public service mission of the land-grant university.
Okay. And you said Sacramento classes. And are there any of those classes in Davis?
Yes, there are. I mean, we have locations both. I mean, our Graduate School of Management also has a center in Sacramento for its weekend and nighttime MBA program. And actually, UC Davis also has another weekend and nighttime MBA program in the Bay Area in San Ramon. Okay. So UC Davis, really, we do stretch from the Sierra with our Lake Tahoe Research Center to the sea at with our Bodega Marine Lab. And we're very far flung.
Yeah. So you've talked a lot about the agriculture side of UC Davis. Can you tell me about the literature side? And tell me what about UC Davis is special in terms of the English department?
Well, let's take some literature altogether. I mean, we have a great English department, but we have courses, for example, that build on some of the interests that our students have here at this university. I mean, naturally, we have courses on the greats of English literature, on Shakespeare and Milton, mm-hmm. and certainly more recent authors. But there's a long tradition of nature poetry, and even let's call it environmental literature. And so many of our students have interests in that. We offer courses on that.
Okay, what is environmental literature? Just literature based off of things in the environment?
Well, for example, it could be literature that describes how an individual may have had a transformational experience by going into the mountains and getting to appreciate the rhythm of the seasons. You're asking me something that I'm personally not a specialist on, but you know, what I might talk about as well is some of the faculty that we've hired in the humanities and arts who work on the interface between the arts or literature and science and discovery. So given the fact that we're such a science-heavy campus, mm-hmm. Any number of programs that I can think of, my own Department of Classics, I think Spanish and Portuguese, have hired people who look at science as it was evolving in different periods and how that was an expression of the culture of the age. And courses are built around that. I'm very proud of the Department of Classics, one of my home departments, because they are very, very welcoming of students. And for example, they have a course that they teach for a lot of pre-med students, biology majors.
Right.
And all of those words, as you know, are built on Latin or Greek roots. And so it can help from the science side learning all this material if you know more about the words. But my colleagues use this as an opportunity to have that introduction to the words themselves serve as a door onto ancient culture. We also have, just to expand on this, we have courses on ethics in science and biology in medicine, for example. We also have great strength and one of the only minors in human rights studies.
Wow.
Yeah, so, you know.
Can you tell me a little bit about that after?
Sure. We have a number of faculty in different places in the university who focus on human rights. It's something that our School of Law works on. But, you know, one of the things that I think is true of many students today, certainly true of Davis students, is they want to make a difference in the world. And, you know, I'm someone who works as a scholar in studying other languages other than English, and more distant times and places. And who knows why I was motivated. I speculated on Tolkien. But I think that many of our students get excited about doing that when they see that there are contemporary families and whole cities and countries where they would like to get involved, perhaps travel there and help them. And, you know, just knowing about, if you're going to interact with people, you have to know their culture, if possible, their language. So I think that working in human rights and all the very many complex political and international relations issues that you get involved with. It's also an opportunity to learn firsthand as much as you can about the culture, the religion, the customs. And of course, there's, in my view, there's no better way to begin to get a deep knowledge of that other than learning the language.
Which you said you did in Germany.
In Germany,
learning German.
Yeah.
Do you know any other languages besides German?
Well, I mean, I read classical Latin and ancient Greek, but in terms of my sort of everyday use, we'll limit it to German, French, and Italian.
Oh, wow. So, yes, you do. Have you visited those places as well?
Oh, absolutely. You know, at this point, it's a little rusty, and sometimes the first day or two of gibberish will emerge. I'll mix up German roots and French grammar forms, but after a while it gets straightened out.
Okay. So back to UC Davis values. Have you found that UCD shares similar values to the people in the city of Davis? Like, how has the Davis community affected the UC Davis community and vice versa?
My goodness, Davis is clearly a small town. It you know, was an agricultural depot before it was a college town. I think the establishment of the university farm just fit with that. But now we're talking about a time over a century ago. I think there's a certain there's a deep honesty in Davis and at UC Davis. Certainly a concern for other people, the opposite of arrogance. But I think that by virtue of being the host to what is now a mammoth university with a very, very international population over the years, of course, UC Davis draws students and faculty and staff from around the world, and that has greatly impacted Davis. It is home to a very international population of families, and you know, I think it's particularly nice. I don't know that there. I mean, a college town tends to have a more cosmopolitan selection of restaurants.
Right.
Another small town, and personally, I think that's a wonderful thing.
It's delicious.
I think it's great. And so I like to think even citizens of Davis who might not be directly connected to the university profit from that, in the fact that we have all of that.
More diversity.
Right.
Here as well. How do you address the needs of international students?
Well, you know, it's something that we're still busy learning, because we have a wonderful set of staff who are helping them in the first instance. But over the years, we've realized that we probably need to have academic advisors who think quite intentionally about the needs of international students.
Okay.
It doesn't necessarily be an entire different set of advisors, but we want to try to help our advisors be ready to consider what particular challenges international students have.
What are some of those challenges?
Well, for example, that they might not feel empowered to ask a question.
Okay.
Or go to a faculty member's office hours. Or they might feel shy about saying to a faculty member, "I don't understand this." You know, I think there are things that you as a student here just take for granted, you know, and you've grown up with it. It's the culture.
Right.
You know? Yes, different people have different approaches to that, but you certainly know that, well, heck, if I don't understand something, I'll go to the professor's office hours and say, "Can you help me on this?" But not every student knows that. Or, for example, I'm now going to think about graduate students. Of course, everyone feels a great deal of loyalty to the faculty member you're working for and who's your advisor, but sometimes some stresses develop. And, you know, I've known some international students who felt, gosh, I would like to go to my professor and say, actually, I want to work on a different topic, but who felt very constrained about doing that. So there's some, you know, the interface between the learning and the culture is one of the things. And so, you know, it's all part of being open to cultural differences, which we have, of course, within our American and California population, but also internationally. I was going to say that we also have, as a wonderful partner, International House, which is right across Russell Boulevard from us. And also we have in the community both folks who have international heritage themselves of recent memory, and many who don't, who love to be host families for our international students and families and help them feel at home in the community.
Okay, and the advisors give them advice on how to excel in the community?
Well, they certainly point their way to International House, but the advisors are, certainly the academic advisors are more helping them advance in their work. But we also, we have, for example, some of our American UC Davis students volunteer to serve as ambassadors and partner up, you know, just be buddies with international students, which is great for, you know, English practice. Mm-hmm. You know, I know this having been a student in another, in a country where another language is spoken, is if you are with another group of Americans, say, in a study abroad program, you're really not going to get the practice that you need or the opportunity. You know, maybe it's more challenging. You put yourself out there, but you can learn so much more about the language and the cultures if you can find a way to be integrated, have live with families.
Okay, and this is a program you sign up for?
Yes, exactly. We also have a number of students who come here, and this is something else that University Extension runs, mm-hmm. which is English language education with a cultural component. And it's possible to take that program and sign up to actually live in the home of families in Davis.
So as like a permanent residence, or just to live for a certain
a number of weeks? When you're taking the course, you live in the community. And I've heard stories of families, of course, taking them on picnics, or of course, if it's during the school year, families will invite people over for, say, Thanksgiving dinner. It's very important.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. We did, when I was growing up, we had a series of international students that we hosted, which helped open my mind to the world.
Yeah, so it benefited you as well as the international
Indeed,
student.
Absolutely.
And any family in Davis can sign up for this program?
I think so.
Wow. That's really amazing that opportunity exists. So scheduling classes has been hard for a lot of students, and a lot of people have to take a fifth year of school. Is there anything that's being done to help that problem?
So when I did arrive, I discovered there was sort of a chronic problem of wait lists for gateway classes. And I was provost, I definitely urged the colleges, and I provided some additional resources to not regard wait lists as something we were always going to have. But, you know, my goodness, if you know there are this many people who need to take the class, let's provide the sections. And from what I understand from my vice provost for undergraduate education, we had more or less, this doesn't mean that every student always gets the class that he or she wants at the time they want, but we had pretty much eliminated the wait list when suddenly we were asked to take more California students. So we have a new influx, and so we're going to go through that process again. But there's some other things that we're doing to try to help, certainly, that logjam. One of the things that we're doing is that we, working with the faculty, discovered that we hadn't looked at our pattern of prerequisites for a very long time, and there were some places where the prerequisites that were listed in the catalog were outdated. Faculty and students weren't really necessarily paying much attention to it, which could sometimes lead to students who weren't really ready to take a certain class being in that class and not doing particularly well and wanting to take it a second time,
while they were occupying
seats that some other students who might have been really ready to take that class weren't able to get into. So we hope that, again, in partnership with the Academic Senate, this careful look and new management of prerequisites will help. You know, and finally, I want to say is that, you know, the fifth year, our actual average is something like 4 years and 1/4.
Okay.
So there are many people.
So it's not a complete fifth year.
No, absolutely not. There are people who take that time, and you know, I have to say there are reasons why people want to do it. They might have decided to take a quarter abroad or a whole year abroad, or do something like that. I mean, I more often than not meet students who are choosing to take another quarter rather than they were forced into it. You know.
Got it. And would these solutions also help with overcrowded lecture halls?
Well, so one of the most important things is we're now building a new large lecture hall.
Okay, where's that going to be?
It's going to be at the corner of California and, oh my goodness, I'm not exactly remembering the cross street on campus, but it's on campus, of course, in the center of campus. I can see the spot. It's not all that far from the MU, and it will be nearly 600 seats.
Oh.
Interestingly enough, we've looked, you know, class, even lectures are becoming more interactive. So the way this classroom will be laid out is instead of seats that have a little arm that comes up with the desk, in front of everyone is a long desk between the rolls. Rows, and it's only very slightly raked, so in fact the seats will swivel, and you could instantly make a group of 4 or 6 students who will work together over a workspace on a project or a question together, and then we can swivel back, and it's a a standard lecture hall facing one direction.
So collaboration will be more prioritized
because there's more and more idea of flipping the classroom, that is, using lots of other means to have students access the information and then making the classroom experience, even a lecture experience, much more interactive. So that's under construction and should open the winter quarter of 2018.
Okay.
So in the meantime, we're actually using the Mondavi Center for classes.
Oh, really?
Which is a beautiful space. I don't know if you've been into Jackson Hall.
Oh, I have been there. Yes, I love it.
But they were very, very welcoming of students. It's several mornings a week. And, of course, they then have their own rehearsals and other things to set up. But we teach there as well. And I don't know whether we'll continue doing that after the new lecture hall is open. But we definitely have to continue expanding our classroom repertoire so that we have enough spaces for the students.
Okay, and final question. Our next guest on What's Going On is Kevin Blue, UC Davis's new athletic director. And Kevin was your first major hire. Can you talk about the selection process and why you think people should watch our interview with Kevin next week?
Kevin is fabulous. I'm very, very privileged to have been able to select him and recruit him to UC Davis. Yes, you're right. The process had gone very far down in the in the meetings with the candidates when I was asked to step into this role. I took the opportunity to meet all the finalists or interact with them in one way or another, and some of them were phone interviews. But I did look again at the work that the selection advisory committee had done, and I reviewed all the material, and I was very, very impressed with Kevin. Kevin has a real vision, as I know he'll tell you, for and passion for the scholar athlete. I mean, one of the things that we're most proud of at UC Davis is that our athletes in all of the sports take their majors across the university. I've met varsity players who are engineers or philosophers, and they also perform at an extremely high level in terms of their academics. And Kevin regards that as the ideal to have, and he has some really interesting ideas about how we can make our program distinctive so that more talented scholar athletes want to come to UC Davis.
Okay, so you're looking at not just the athletic abilities, but the educational abilities as well.
Absolutely. I mean, I think if you're going to come to a UC, first of all, you have to be at a certain level.
Right,
no
of
doubt
course.
About it. And also, I think it's forgive me if this sounds overly dramatic, but it's really a holy obligation we have to anyone who comes here, whether they're outside activity is music or student government or sports. And if you're going to do varsity sports, it's an enormous investment of time.
Right.
But we have to make sure that we enable you at the same time to have a full and complete and valuable experience as a student.
Wow. That's a really great opportunity. And
well, you know, I mean, probably Kevin will say this, but, you know, sometimes people think that if you're going to have great athletic achievement, you have to give up on the academic, and he absolutely does not believe that's true. And that's one of the reasons why I know he's the right athletic director for us, and that his passion and commitment to that is going to serve the student athletes and the goals of our entire university.
Sounds like a good reason to watch the show, to hear what
Absolutely.
He has to say.
I'll do it myself.
All right, well, thank you very much for being here today. This is What's Going On. Thank you for watching, and have a good evening.
Thank you.